Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Johan Swinnen. I'm from the University of Leuven. My team was part of the food secure project and program, and I have the great honor of chairing the policy panel this afternoon. Obviously, this policy panel is a very important panel in the sense that it discusses what are the implications of our research and what do people from outside or involved in the decision-making institutions think of it, and what do they have to add or to comment on or give ideas for further work. I'm going to make very brief introductions to the speakers because we have a panel of very distinguished speakers, and if I have to go through their biography, I probably will take up half the time of which is allocated to the panel. The first presenter is Jean-Christophe Bureau, and the second speaker will be Lara Cockx, and I will then briefly, I'm not on the program there, but I will use 5 minutes to say something about global value chains and standards and how that relates to food and nutrition security. And then we'll move on to the other guest on the policy panel, which is Mahendra Dev, Roberto Ridolfi, who is replaced by Jean-Pierre Halkin, and Tassos Haniotis. Jean-Christophe, please, you have the floor. Jean-Christophe Bureau is, as I'm sure that many of all of you know, is a professor in Paris at INRA, and he has been involved in many discussions, preparations, analyses of agricultural policy in Europe. Jean-Christophe.
Thank you, Jo. So the idea is to present briefly some of the key findings of Food Secure regarding the impact of European Union policies that affects markets, global markets, but more generally food security. There are many European policies that may affect food security. You have here a graph, I think it's Leuven who did this graph, showing that all the items at the bottom could have some impact, including macroeconomic monetary policies. But in Food Secure, we're focused on agricultural policy, bioenergy, climate, trade policy, and I won't mention development policy because Lara will address that. We'll know that the coherence historically of these policies has long been unclear, and that the overall impact of all of this on food security in developing countries has long been controversial, and we have had some meetings with a stakeholder that has confirmed that it was controversial. So in terms of agricultural policies, what we found is that the EU agricultural policy no longer has this very large distorting effect on world markets that it used to have when the EU used export refunds, variable levies to stabilize its internal market at the expense of other countries. We still have some instruments such as the possibility to adjust tariffs, and for example on cereals. We did that, the EU did that in the mid-1990s and in 2008. This still has an impact in terms of price fluctuation, but what we found is that the main amount of money, which has the direct payments, didn't have a very visible impact on markets, on world markets, and hence on food security. So you can say it was raised by the stakeholders that maybe you see nothing because you don't have the right instruments. It's true that this big amount of payments must have some production impact, but we did some kind of sophisticated modeling, the people at INRA and REN in particular, on the what I would call the second order effects of these payments through risk aversion, through the wealth effect, and of course they found something, but it's not that big to that we can measure the consequences in terms of food security, especially compared to the evolution of agricultural policies in other large countries where you see all kind of recoupling of payments and so on. The bioenergy policy is much more controversial because the biofuel program shows some similarity with the former intervention policy that we had in agriculture, such as taking some quantities out of the food market to put it in a third market. But it's very different because we used to put it, the third market used to be the world market, and now it's the energy market. And the price consequences, the world price consequences, are extremely different. So we don't see the negative effects on producers for developing countries. The impact on consumers is more questionable on this, but it was already raised this morning by Christophe Well. A lesson that that we have is from this project is that we need to consider the indirect effects. The indirect effect of not only the biofuel policy through the indirect land use changes, which is now pretty much well known, but it's also the case for many other policies, including policies that, for example, could correspond to a reform of the agricultural policy or to the climate policy, because all these policies have some impact on the world, on the vector of world prices, hence this indirect effect. When you we have some simulations that are still unpublished because it's a bit difficult to have a clear message on this, but if we turn, for example, the European agriculture much greener with some radical measures such as much more organic farming and so on, we change the price vector, and the indirect consequences are, let's say, counterintuitive in some cases, especially in the case of greenhouse gas effects. The balance is not that fantastic because of the price effects that leads to put some pasture in crops for inarable crops in other parts of the world. So one lesson is that we really need this extra layer of modeling in the life cycle assessment and more generally in the sustainability impact assessment. Regarding trade policies, we've done a lot of work in these work packages. What we do not identify a very significant effect of the EU trade policy on food security. The EU has granted very generous preferences to the poorest countries. To be honest, in terms of modeling, we don't see that much effect that we are able to measure because the exports are somewhat limited by non-tariff issues, by supply-side constraints. We have, and this has been raised a lot with the meeting with the stakeholders, we have some ambiguous effects on the economic partnership agreements with the African, Caribbean, Pacific region. Again, we see some macroeconomic effects, we see some tariff revenues effects, but the link to food security is relatively limited. So one point that was strongly stressed by the stakeholders is that when we design EU policy, we need to think of many consequences in terms of taking into account the fact that there are also bad institutions, poorly working institutions in third countries. And one example is, again, the biofuel issue, where we have a policy that was designed to reduce greenhouse gases emission and also to provide an outlet for European farmers at some point in the early 2000s. And this policy, in spite of some changes that were designed to improve this policy, such as double counting the feedstock that came from waste, for example, ends up, favoring imports of palm oil with extremely controversial consequences. So that shows that in that case, but also in many other cases, even well-intended policies can have some questionable food security effect. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jean-Christophe. We have, I'm sure, your presentation will raise some issues, questions, people who want to comment on that. And we will have, hopefully, plenty of time at the end to take all that in. So we're going to go through all the presentations first, and then we will open it up for discussion and comments. The next presenter is Lara Cockx. Lara is a researcher at the Center for Institutions and Economic Performance at the University of Leuven. Lara?
Right. Good afternoon, everyone. I will be talking about development policies, and in particular, the effectiveness and coherence of EU aid for food and nutrition security. So within the Food Secure Project, we had two main questions with regards to these policies. First of all, we wanted to get an idea of what activities donors are currently engaging in and what interventions have actually been shown to successfully improve recipients' food and nutrition security status. And the next thing we wanted to focus on within this project is the coherence of development policies. And just to clarify what I mean with coherence, because the concept has a lot of different interpretations, we will not be talking about horizontal coherence, so the coherence between development policies and other EU policies. Rather, we focused on vertical coherence, which is linked to concepts in EU jargon of coordination and complementarity. So we want to assess to what extent the Commission is actually coordinating with member states in terms of development policies. And then we also focus on donor-recipient coherence, which is commonly known as alignment and the concept of country ownership. So what do we find is that despite the renewed interest and elevated levels of funding for food and nutrition security interventions, the evidence base for the effectiveness is surprisingly weak. And then with regards to the coherence, we see that there is a wide gap between rhetoric and reality. The European Union has been very committed in a political sense towards enhancing coordination of development policies, but when we quantitatively assess the progress over time, we see that in reality change has been limited. We also note that there might have to be some more discussion about the optimal level of coherence, because intuitively it seems reasonable to think that more coherence is always better, but then when you think about the practical implementation of these initiatives, for example, concentrating on a limited number of sectors or a limited number of recipient countries, it's less clear what would be the optimal level of coherence. If we think about limiting the number of donors per country, there can be economies at scale at first, so we don't want just one donor for every recipient countries, but then in the end, transaction costs, because of dealing with these multitude of donors, take over, and then there is a problem. That's why concentration is usually advocated for. And then finally, we should also be aware that there are important trade-offs between these different types of coherence. One that I can think of is by improving coordination between donors, and for example, having limited numbers of donors in a specific sector or a specific country, you could actually undermine recipient country ownership, because the bargaining position of donors becomes stronger. So going to the background a bit, what we did specifically is we reviewed the empirical evidence on the impact of food and nutrition security interventions. We were very strict in our definition of what we considered as impact studies and what we considered as food and nutrition security interventions, and obviously this is subject of debate. So what we considered as interventions here are in-kind food assistance, or really food aid interventions, social protection, so then we're talking about cash transfers, conditional or unconditional, nutrition-specific interventions, these are really supplementation interventions, agricultural interventions, of course, and also water hygiene and sanitation interventions. And then finally, for the financial tracking of the aid flows, we also considered rural development. But in practice, of course, rural development kind of covers all the other categories mentioned there. And then perhaps even more important, we only considered studies that included evidence on the impact of measures directly related to individual and household food and nutrition security status. So we're really talking about studies that look at caloric intake or micronutrient composition, and not studies documenting, for example, the impact on income, despite the fact that you can assume that this might have a positive effect on food and nutrition security. We are really only looking at studies that specifically, explicitly measure food security. And what we then see is that, in fact, large parts of the EU budget are allocated to intervention for which there is limited, in the sense that there are few studies addressing this issue, or scarce evidence of positive impact of food nutrition on the food and nutrition security status of recipients. And to illustrate this a bit, this is a graph of the budget flows that we consider as aid for food and nutrition security. As you can see, of course, there's been a serious elevation of funding after the food price crisis. But then when we look at the allocation of the budget and what has actually been shown to be successful, we see that half of the budget is being allocated to agriculture, while in fact studies have shown that there is a positive effect of these kinds of intervention on income, but the direct effect on food security status remains unclear, and there are very few studies actually addressing this, and the evidence is very inconclusive. Another example, I heard a lot of people talking today already about school feeding programs or food for education programs. In fact, there are a lot of studies that actually document that this is not a very effective strategy, and still almost all food insecure countries continue to implement these types of programs. So there seems to be a disconnect between what finding science has produced and how budgets are being allocated. Moving on to policy coherence. So the first dimension we want to address is the coherence between different member states' policies. And this is related to the problem of age proliferation, the fact that resources are being spread too thinly across different countries and different sectors. So this map depicts the number of EU donors in the bubbles and at the same time also the total amount of funding that countries are receiving. And as you can see, even in countries that are not receiving very large amounts of aid in total, the countries have to deal with up to 10 donors just in this area alone. One way of improving coherence of aid is selecting a limited number of recipient countries and focusing on a number of sectors. And the EU in 2007 has actually come up with a code of conduct of division of labor, where they call for donors to focus on a selected number of countries and focus on two sectors. In reality, what we see is that the European Commission itself in 2013 had 113 partner countries. And this is when we are only focusing on aid for food and nutrition security. Large donors such as France also have over 80 and 90 recipient countries, and almost all donors are active in all six sectors when we focus on their main recipient countries. Of course, this is a very simplistic way of assessing this, and we did a more intricate analysis of proliferation. So we concentrated an index that measures the concentration of aid flows in the assumption that an improved concentration of aid flows will improve coherence between the member states. And we see that despite political commitment and this code of conduct, progress in increasing concentration in terms of recipient countries and sectors has remained limited over time, especially also because the new member states are still expanding their portfolios and therefore increasingly contributing to this proliferation. The next thing we also assessed, in line with this idea of complementarity between EU member states' policies and the European Commission policies, is the overlap between EU institutions and member states. Because of course, you can think of a situation where, despite the fact that you are focusing on a smaller number of recipient countries, if you are focusing all on the same countries, this will not improve coherence of policies. So that's why we also assess this overlap. And here the picture is actually even more bleak. We do not see any sign of improvement over time. So this remains the same despite a lot of policy attention for this problem. And finally, moving on to the dimension of coherence between donors and their recipients. So this is related to the principles of country ownership or democratic country ownership and alignment. We see that there has been a lot of attention for these concepts, especially in line with the Paris Declaration and other efforts, but actually they are poorly understood and often conceptualized in a very narrow and procedural way. So usually they focus on countries writing a poverty reduction strategy paper. And once you have written this, you are supposed to have country ownership of policies, while in reality, the more complicated political issues are sidelined. And then also, even when only focusing on this procedural aspect, we see that progress has remained limited. A case study from Ethiopia, also elaborated within FoodSecure, also shows how difficult it is to actually acquire country ownership, that it is a result of historical factors and economical conditions. So it remains to be seen to what extent donors can actually or should actually play an active role in achieving this. And then finally, another study that was conducted between FoodSecure on the dimension of coherence between policy areas within a country shows that the initial focus on availability has firmly rooted policies in agriculture, and the predominance of this vision hampers intersectoral coordination, and donors actually often contribute to this lack of coordination by the fact that their internal organization is also structured among these pillars, further hampering intersectoral coordination. So in terms of policy implications, there's a very urgent need for more research on food and nutrition security interventions. There should be a strict focus on food and nutrition security rather than intermediate outcomes such as income, for example. There's also a complete lack of studies that document longer term effects. And especially from the view of allocating scarce resources of development aids, there would be a lot of interest in studies that actually compare the results of different interventions so that we know where to allocate our money to achieve best results. In terms of improving coherence, The EU Code of Conduct on Complementarity and Division of Labour has actually been heralded as one of the most promising policy initiatives, but the implementation is lagging behind. So one solution would be to improve the implementation and enforce implementation. There is a lot of work on joint programming, of course, which is another route to take if you want to improve coherence. Rather than dividing labor, you could actually work on improving coordination between donors when they are working in the same country. So that's about strengthening collaboration. And then finally, I think we should reopen the debate on the optimal level of country ownership and to what extent donors can play an active role in achieving this. Thank you.
Okay, Lara, thank you very much. I think that, just like the first presentation, this presentation will also raise, I mean, Lara raised a lot of issues, which I think will invite comments and questions. I will briefly review some points where the organizers have asked me to comment on. And so this has to do with the issue of, so Jean-Christophe talked about several, like agriculture, bioenergy, trade, etc. And so I was asked maybe to comment a little bit more on what the changes that have taken place inside our food system or the world's food system and what that implies for policy. The key message actually of the presentation of all our work, which we have been doing about it in the past 4 years, is that the world's agri-food system have been dramatically transformed. So you've had major institutional reforms globally and affecting the food system. We have a restructuring of value chains, the growth of standards, and all this has very large and complex and heterogeneous implication for food and nutrition security, and that is also reflected on the policy front where, as I will argue, the implications are vast, okay, but the implications are not simple, they are actually quite complex. And in that way, my message is quite linked to Jean-Christophe's message in terms of nuanced and complex implications. So I think we're living in a very different food world today than, let's say, a decade ago, and certainly 25 years ago. So the first one is that we've seen across the world major liberalization of food systems. We've had the most dramatic ones were obviously in Eastern Europe, the former Soviet Union, China, Vietnam, etc. But also in Africa, there's been a strong liberalization of the food systems with the structural adjustment programs, and of course in our country here in the Europe, we had major reforms of the common agricultural policy. Another point is that we've seen globally a consolidation and modernization of food value chains. This is an indicator of the number of supermarkets in China. I like this one because it shows the spectacular change. And of course, it has gone on since then, and these things are taking place also in many places in Africa right now. With that, we've seen a spread of food standards. On the left-hand side is the SPS notification to the WTO. This is indicator of public food standards. On the right-hand side is the number of global gap reduced, indicator of private food standards. And in both slideshows, there's basically been an explosion of these standards. So here is, despite the growth of standards, okay, and the more stringency, okay, we still see very strong increases from exports from developing countries. Left is sub-Saharan cacao exports, and on the right side is developing country horticultural exports. And all, particularly the horticulture one, but also the cacao one, are increasingly having to address much more stringent standards than in the past. So what does that imply? So as I said already, it's complex and it's heterogeneous. Just to give you a very brief summary of some of our findings. So food standards are benefiting the consumers in general by reducing asymmetric information, but these benefits may be partially or completely offset because of the price increases which are implied. The modern retail outlets and basically this transforming food processing system, etc., they also affect food and nutrition security, but the impact may be mixed because at the same time there's more diversity of food, probably higher quality, prices may be higher or lower, there's different studies on that, and obviously there's more processed foods which may affect obesity issues even in developing countries. On the supply side, there studies find that standards can be both catalyst or barriers to trade, and this is a really big issue in the trade arena where many countries are essentially saying that the EU food standards are essentially non-tariff barriers to trade, so they should be dealt as such. The evidence on that is, I think the theory behind it, the conception is very simplistic and it's not very realistic. So if you build more complicated trade models, then you find that the impact is actually quite sophisticated and hard to measure. And that's also what the evidence shows, okay, that it's really hard to measure the benefits to consumers and basically the trade distorting effect. And many studies show different things, so there's a mixture of findings. At the household level, we find similar things, that there's a very strong mixture of findings whether smallholders are integrated in these new value chains. In some countries they are, in some countries they are not, in some countries they are. It's a mixture of large and small farm. Okay, so we find lots of different things. So what does that imply for food and nutrition security? Well, the smallholder integration affects families, poor families, and their food consumption in various ways, through income, through health, there's gender effects, there's access to inputs, and there's spillovers, okay? So these, we have increasingly more details on this. What is missing in the debate often, okay, is that when there is no smallholder integration, that basically on the large farming, there's a lot of rural employment creation going on, and this is typically affecting the poorest people in the rural societies, and with often gender bias towards women hiring, and this has major impact on food and nutrition security as well. So what are the policy implications? Well, they are, there's a whole bunch of them. I obviously don't have the time to go through all of them. I'm just going to point out a few. The first one is that this is the way we did agriculture policy evaluation in the old days. Okay, we had intervention prices and tariffs, etc., calculated these things. So this is the new discussion. It's not unfair prices, but or unfair tariffs, but it's unfair trading practices. And so the question is, how can you get the farmer's share of the value in the chain larger through value chain reorganization? In terms of the areas, I think one of the most important things is actually to realize that these changes have taken place and that these are really having an impact on how the markets are functioning, and that this, of course, influences the way policies are affecting various people in the value chains, both on the consumption side and on the production side. The trade policy, I think there the issue is making our standards so that they are catalysts to trade and are no barriers to trade. Agricultural policy, Jean-Christophe talked more on this than I will do here. The investment and macroeconomic policy is a very general thing, okay, but I think it's probably, it may be one of the most important things, because if the investment climate is not there, you cannot get these value chains going. And then there is a number of issues which are specific to the value chains, which is that the labor market effects, we should recognize them and stimulate them, in my view. Competition policy is obviously important when they get concentrated. How does that affect the relationship with the farmers and of course, with the farming households? And I think we should see these value chains much more as a mechanism for rural finance and technology transfer than we have done so far, than the traditional policies are tend to do. And these, what we find, have major implications for rural poverty reduction and therefore through the income effects on basically the food security of these households. That was it. Thank you. All right, I'm putting up my chairman hat again. I will now introduce the discussants. The first discussant is Mahendra Dev. Professor Dev is a very distinguished Indian development economist. He is the director of the IGIDR, the Indira Gandhi Institute in Mumbai, and he's also on the board of IFPRI. Mahendra, please. Sure.
Thank you. Good afternoon. So I have 4 points on the impact of European policies on food and nutrition security of developing countries. At the outset, you know, we heard the good news yesterday that the hunger index for developing countries improved by nearly 30%, precisely 29%. Although there are many challenges now on the hunger side. On European policies, you know, it can have impact on developing countries at two levels. One is shaping the global agenda relating to SDGs, the Sun Movement, and other things. The second is the role at the national level. So Europe has a key role at these two levels. Basically, EU should ensure that investments and actions are aligned with the priorities of developing countries regarding food and nutrition security. In the case of FNS, there are 3 pillars One is agriculture, second, the role of women, and third is health. So in fact, if you see some of the empirical studies, one third kind of thing for contributing to the food and nutrition security. My first point is on agriculture-related policies of EU, on trade. The new SDG goals also talk about removing the distortions in trade and distorted agriculture markets. We have some of the demands, of developing countries at WTO, including India, on public stocks and all. I mean, one has to solve. But in general, we should have less distorted markets. I know EU has done some removed some of the distortions, but we still have US and other countries. So basically, protectionism and currency wars are increasing. This is not going to help the developing countries. Trade policy and rules can help governments to achieve 2030 agenda of food and nutritional security and doubling of productivity and incomes of smallholders if there are no distorted trade and markets. And also reduce the price volatility. And Joe has mentioned about the value chains, which are important for also, I think, better prices for the farmers. Because if you see some of the markets, even if prices are increasing, for example, I see in tomatoes, I went and checked, 1 rupee per kg farmers are getting. But in urban markets, you buy for 50 rupees in India. So how much the difference between farmers getting the prices and the urban consumers have to pay? My second point is on technology. I know the traditional technologies and all helped, including the harvest plus biofortification and all, the conventional technology helped. But the point I'm going to say is maybe a bit controversial, the GM crops. Maybe EU is not allowing these GM crops. We are denying the poor farmers in Africa, probably by not allowing this technology. So because it has advantage of less pesticides and also saving output, even if sometimes it may not increase the yields, but also it is increasing the yields. So like the Green Revolution technology, it may be land saving, even forest saving kind of thing. So climate change, resilient crops, probably the technology is important. So this probably they should start the dialogue on these GM crops. My second point is on inequalities. We also have a session in the morning on inequalities. The goal 10 of SDGs talks about inequality. See, increasing inequality may hamper 2030 agenda of reducing food and nutrition security. So I think we need more research, although this project has one of the components on inequalities, on how the inequalities, how to reduce and then impact the food and nutrition security, how to help the small farmers, women, less advantaged social groups, rain-fed areas. So that is important. On climate change, there are two related on consumption patterns. There are two types of inequalities. One is between advanced countries and developing countries, the one inequality. But within developing countries, the rich and poor inequalities are getting. In fact, the consumption patterns of the rich in developing countries are more or less equal to the rich in advanced countries. So one has to talk about these inequalities also. My third point is on coming to nutrition security. Malnutrition is concentrated in Africa and South Asia. So focus on Africa is important. They have more problems. But if you want to achieve the number by 2030, I think South Asia also one has to focus. I may have conflict of interest, but the South Asia numbers are very high, India, Bangladesh, and other countries. So if you want to achieve the 2030, hunger and malnutrition problem, we have to concentrate both on equally. My last point is on, for example, in the nutrition security, the Harvest Plus is trying, you know, 1 billion population want to have by 2030. So if, then you have to have focus on South Asia apart from Africa. My last point is on intersectoral coordination. They mentioned earlier, you know, this is one of the important things for food and nutrition security. I'm talking about more horizontal than vertical between Europe and developing countries, because the some concentrate only on production and trade, forgetting the other things. In fact, agriculture and nutrition, there are three disconnects. One is agriculturists and nutritionists are coming together, but still they are not, you know, many places they are not working together, agriculture and nutritionists. And second is the at the policy level, there is a disconnect between across sectors. Third level is the data disconnect between agriculture, because agriculture surveys don't have nutrition, nutrition surveys don't have agriculture. Coming to policy convergence, for example, women component is one of the crucial things for nutrition. For example, a study in Maharashtra showed that agriculture and nutrition are connected, but provided women's empowerment is there. So you need to have women's empowerment and also social protection, the sanitation and those kind of issues. On social protection, of course, people are talking about universal basic income in some of the countries. In Europe also, they're talking about whether cash transfers or this universal basic income one has to discuss. On sanitation, in fact, in India, you know, 50% of the malnutrition can be explained through sanitation. So a lot of coordination is important. In fact, Angus Deaton's book, Great Escape, talks about, you know, on health, how people have, you know, longevity and all has increased. So to conclude, European Union can help the world in great escape of hunger and malnutrition by 2030. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mahendra. Our next discussant speaker is from DG DEVCO, from the European Commission, is Jean-Pierre Halkin. Jean-Pierre is well known, I think, to many of us in this field, and we're very happy he could be here. He is the head of unit in charge of rural development and food and nutrition security, so he's excellently placed to give his perspective on this.
Thank you very much, Joe. First of all, I would like to really thank the organizer for inviting us to attend this event, which is really important for the whole development family. Second is that I will focus most of my intervention as a response to the presentation of the report made by Lara. And I must say that when I was listening to Lara, it was reminding me more and more a TV show I saw 2 days ago, where a smart lady was explaining to a poor man that he was not qualified for the job he was trying to apply for. But to start, the report is certainly extremely useful and important. It is drafted with no complacency. I will put more perspective, but we certainly agree with most of the findings made by the report. And we need to know what we need to, what we shall and must improve in order to move forward. One of the major elements of the report is certainly the weak evidences about the impact of EU assistance in food and nutrition security. This is something which is tremendously important, and we must make progress on that, and I will come back to it at the end of my intervention. We have at this stage plausible information on the success of our policies, notably on resilience. We have seen countries facing unprecedented climatic event together with, which are combined with demographic growth in the Sahel and in the Horn of Africa, with a level of food insecurity and also level of stunting, which have remained basically quite stable. And we may assume that this has not been happening by a miracle, but it is a result of first the right policies implemented by the government and also the efficiency of the international community. There are some issues where we can disagree, certainly the amount presented regarding the what is devoted in the fields of external assistance to food and nutrient security. We have a much higher amount, but it is not really the purpose of the debate. What is really striking and where we do agree is certainly the fact that EU and member states need to do better in the context of labor division. That's something which is clearly showed with a very explicit and also pedagogic graphic representation. It was very clear also in the first report we did on joint EU implementation of the food and nutrition security policy. For your information, it is the only area where EU and member states are presenting a joint report. So that's very important that we move forward on that. This type of information is helping us to say that diversity is good as long as it is not too extreme. That's something very important. And we've seen, for instance, in one country that to disperse 8 million euro, we needed also 8 donors to be present. So there, clearly, the transaction cost is excessive. That's something important. We've done the first report in 2014 using the 2012 data. We did the second report in 2016 using 2014 data. It shows that at least if we are not going as far as we want in division of labor, we are moving in the right direction. We are also moving in the right direction regarding joint programming. That's something extremely important, that if we are together in the same country, we plan together. And we're moving really strongly in that direction with now 14 countries where we are in joint programming on food and nutrition security at least. That's something where we see progress, and we hope to see more progress on that. Another area where we can see progress which goes beyond the EU is certainly the way we work with the UN agency in order to prevent food crisis. In 2016, whenever we had to face El Nino, we decided to work together with FAO and WFP to have a joint global assessment on food crisis. And this is the first time we reached that stage of coordination. Our goal is now to move from assessing together to planning and coordinating together, so moving from the joint assessment to what we are calling a global network. We need also a better monitoring framework. That's something very important for the whole of the EU assistance, and it is even more relevant for food and nutrition security. You may know that food and nutrition security is our most important field of intervention. It represents between 20 and 25% of EU assistance devoted to development. It is 60% of humanitarian assistance. And it is a question of efficiency and of accountability. At the end of the financial perspective, we cannot go back to the taxpayer and say, well, we spend $9 billion into food and nutrition security. We need also to be able to provide ideas of impact who are enjoying the full support of the EU citizen. You may know that in the current budget, most of the budget items have been reduced except for external assistance. So we are enjoying a very strong support for solidarity, but we must show to the taxpayer that we are using that well, in addition of just having a higher impact. So on that aspect, we have developed a corporate result framework in EuroPaid. And in this corporate result framework, we have a large amount of indicators which are dedicated to food and nutrition security. Then we also need to speak about the policy framework. I believe that we have been making major progress in the policy framework in the last years. In 2010, we had a new food security policy, which was, I would say, a major overhaul on the former food, basically food aid and food assistance policy, so it was a major step forward. We've complemented this policy with two new policies, one on resilience and the other one on nutrition, recognizing that whenever we are tackling food crisis, we need not only to address the consequences of food crisis, but we also need to address the root causes of food crisis, and we need most of all to support partner countries to be better equipped to address with their own means the consequences of food crisis, and under nutrition because it was somehow a neglected issue and we could rely on evidences provided by the scientific community in the Lancet edition. So on those aspects, we've been moving forward on the framework, but we need now to adapt to the new context and in particular to the SDG so that we have a framework which is in line with the globally agreed framework in which was agreed by global leader in September 2015. There are some aspects where we need to progress which were not mentioned in your intervention, but I believe deserve to be mentioned. And one of all, it's always surprising to see researchers not putting this forward. One of all is certainly the fact that we need to promote research and innovation in development and in particular in agriculture and food and nutrition security. I mean, with the SDG system, we agree that family farmers need to double their productivity while facing unprecedented climatic challenge and while reducing also their use of water, fertilizers. This will not be achievable by a business as usual or even by putting more money in a more of the same approach. Even draining more investment from the private sector will not be sufficient. We need to connect better the research results to the farmers and the actors of the value chain. That's something which is very important. And on our side also, we would like to connect better with the expertise existing in the European Union, in addition of continuing our work with the international research centers, notably the one under the CGIAR umbrella. My conclusion is that we are moving in the right direction, but your report shows that we must intensify our effort. I would like to say also that we need also to abort some other burning questions, which are not really addressed in your report, but were addressed in the previous session. And certainly, whenever we speak about vulnerability, and this morning we spoke also of vulnerability and equity, we need to speak about exclusion of the growth, and we need to speak also about discrimination. We always speak about the need to assist women, for instance, that's very important. We know that also vulnerability is not evenly distributed in a country. Very often some ethnic groups are, for instance, suffering more than others. And we may help them better, but if discrimination or passive discrimination is not addressed, we are not going to have a high level impact on the long run. So that's something extremely important. More important is to consider the way we may intervene efficiently in fragile countries and conflict areas. The share of our assistance going to countries affected by conflict is increasing. It will exceed half of the assistance within the coming years. It is notably the result of what we call the graduation process, where countries which are now emerging countries are not anymore receiving bilateral assistance, but it is also part of the EU policy to make sure that we try to put off the fires which are put on by conflict and violent expression of disagreement. That's something very important. The last point where we need also to work better together and maybe within the Commission, and certainly within the Commission, is global value chain, which we have discussed today, and also what do we understand by a sustainable and global food system, which is an item mentioned in the SDG for which we don't have an agreed understanding. For instance, you were speaking about GMOs. Are GMOs part of the solution or not? At the end, we need also to work closer with researchers, and we need to have more evidences to guide our intervention. And I believe that the first intervenant was very clear in distinguishing between what is a good intention, between to make the difference between a good intention and a high impact action. I mean, if we speak about what will be working to normal citizens, they will start eating organic food and also putting biofuel in their car. Is it going to solve the problem? From the presentation made, certainly not. Thank you.
Thank you, Jean-Pierre. The last presenter or speaker at this distinguished panel is Tassos Haniotis. Again, I think many of you know Tassos for he's been an active participant in debates and presentations for many years in the Brussels arena and beyond Brussels, of course. He is now the Director for Economic Analysis, Perspectives and Evaluation in DG AGRI from the Commission. So Tassos, please.
Thank you, Jo. I'm trying to figure out where am I in this. If somebody, oh, there you go. Yeah, I have some slides. Yeah, there you go. Okay, oops. Good. Okay, now, it's in a sense, when you talk about the common agricultural policy on an issue whose main focus is outside the European Union, maybe a good indication of whether the CAP is playing a positive or a negative role is the fact that most of the focus has been away of these issues. But that doesn't mean that the policy is not there to play a role, and neither does it mean that the fact that we solved some problems in the past is not going to generate more problems in the future. So what I will try to do in the brief time I have is try to look at what has changed in the global environment that is pertinent to the debate we're having today. How does this affect the CAP itself, and how to address new challenges in the future? Starting with a point that I have made in the past also, that food security is a completely different concept in the European Union when we talk about EU agriculture than what it is for the rest of the world. It's not so much an issue of how much we produce, of availability, but the manner in which we produce. But I thought it would be important to start when your project started in 2012. I think it was March that you started. And this is the situation that we were facing that generated all this big debate about food security. It's not only food security. I think this was the time that I participated in a panel in the European Parliament where we were going to run out of oil. Peak oil was 2013 was the year. Now, in this characteristic of co-movement of all commodity prices, high volatility, and very high level of prices, if we look where we are today, we're in a completely different situation. The high price debate of the past has changed completely. Co-movement is evidently not the case anymore. And we're going back to some more fundamental questions we had in agricultural markets, although still clearly not to the full extent. For example, there has been a consistent downward trend in cereal prices in these last 4 years, but still prices are way above what they were in the past. And when it comes to a more esoteric debate in the European Union, if you compare dairy prices in the EU with world market prices, they have been a little bit all over the place for a series of reasons that I do not want to discuss right now. But if you summarize all these developments, and you look at what has happened in commodity prices in longer periods. On the top, you have 97 to 2008. In the bottom, 97 to 2015. In between, you have the in-between periods. What I would like you to take out from this is the following. When prices were moving up, agricultural prices moved up by 30%, fertilizer and energy prices by 300%, 10 times more. When prices started stabilizing at lower levels, agricultural prices are still 10% up in real terms at world level. Energy and fertilizer prices are 10 times higher. So, textbook definition of a deterioration of the terms of trade for global agriculture that applies also inside the European Union. Now, starting with that, what I would try to focus now is on the relevance of the CAP on the food in the in nutritional security. If you look on the three periods, as I call them, of the CAP, which I used first time in the seminar that was organized in the memory of Giovanni Anania, you have the defensive period on the CAP that created all sort of trade distortions in a period that in the world was very different and everybody more or less created their own trade distortions. We passed into a period that I would like to call it more offensive, in the sense that we made major reforms that made us play a bigger role, not just in improving the situation of European agriculture, in limiting the damage done to others, but also leading in the policy reform debate. And ever since the food security debate, we ended up a more uncertain period, not just in agriculture, but overall in terms of the policy leadership and what we need to do. Some call it a lack of vision, others a lack of leadership, whatever it is, the future has become very unknown. And that has implications in the manner by which we work. And Jo has asked me to check also about the difficulties in the policy making. Challenges, one of these is the co-decision. I'm not saying that it's a bad process, I'm saying it's a much more complex process, and unless you pay attention in the type of proposals you make, you end up with things that you would have liked to avoid. There is a mix of all the new type of ideas to address issues, and not always in clear defined priorities. I raise here the volatility issue. We still don't have a clear answer what to do. Some are telling us, go do what the Americans are doing, at the same time that the American policies are about to change. In a sense, I know some of you have also been advocating strategic, virtual, or other type of stocks. If you make a very simple calculation of the price at which we would have bought stocks and the price at which we would have need to sell them right now, you would see that the taxpayers will not be very happy with the end result, and that's part of the reason that we didn't move in that direction. But where we're moving is a more inward-looking process. I put it with a question mark. For me, it's less than a question mark. We do it in terms of trade. 1 in 4 euros of the EU's total surplus in goods, total goods, comes from agriculture. So you would expect that the agri-food would be the sector that would be very open to trade, because we've seen the benefits of that. This is not exactly the case. Science was mentioned. It's not about GMOs. It is about the fact that you have to ask yourself, when will we realize that by technology, in medicine, in waste treatment, and in agriculture is the same science and the same process, and how do you end up identifying what exactly you want to get out of science in general, which is not only by technology. The debate on precision farming, big data is another example. So is the debate on productivity. There are some ideas in the European Union that we should remove ourselves from world markets and go to more labor-intensive agriculture, which means that we should focus more on what is our competitive disadvantage, because our labor costs are always be much higher, and forget what is our competitive advantage, which is exactly value added. Now, in the new policy environment, there are three, I like to call them tensions. That's my term. It's not an official line of the European Commission, if you want. But what is clearly the issues we're dealing with, economy and environment, sustainability and simplification, jobs and growth, have in between themselves the word "and," and sometimes it could be "or." There is an enormous tension between what is the short-term economic advantage that the farmers have by squeezing their cost based on these price developments, and the long-term damage this could do to the environment. And since the markets don't pay for the environment, how exactly you address this issue is a major one, especially because of climate change. There is a significant complexity when national priorities, in the pretense of simplification, end up harming more than the benefit they provide. And this is not an esoteric debate in the European Union. You can extend this debate everywhere, and there has to be a balance between what is an appropriate recognition of national priorities and characteristics, and what is a more global interest. And again, in the context of climate change, this is becoming extremely important. And finally, there is a big question of jobs and growth, or jobs or growth. Agriculture, primary agriculture, is a job loser and will always be a job loser everywhere. That doesn't mean that rural areas have to be job losers. And the real question is how, across the food chain, and in a more horizontal manner, with the services provided in rural areas, the net employment effect is going to be positive, and also is going to add a new dimension in the type of jobs we have, with more knowledge-based, more targeted. And here where, and my personal view, is that climate change is the big issue of this coming century. And I'm not talking about the general targets about how you mitigate climate change. I'm talking about the uncertainty that every citizen feels when we all see that the type of extreme weather events we face are much greater. When we make in our modeling assumptions and calculations, assumptions about the sinking capacity of forests while fires in forests or diseases in forests spread much faster than in the past, and the old results are not pertinent anymore, when animal and plant diseases are spreading very fast in agriculture and the research is lagging behind, when innovation has knowledge that allows us to move into best practices, but this is not happening on the ground because of asymmetries in the transfer of this knowledge and a series of other issues, which lead, of course, not only to more research among researchers, you would like to see the word, but among much more targeted research that is able to anticipate the challenges of the future and come up with more concrete answers. I have one last slide and I will throw it. I thought I wouldn't present it. Somebody asked me over lunch what has changed in the CAP in the last 10 years. This is what has changed in the CAP in the last 10 years. I'm just bringing back this graph. What could change in the CAP in the next 10 years is, in my view, also very important. First is a debate between so-called coupled and decoupled support. Our internal jargon, but it's also, if you want, a forward-looking or a backward-looking type of policy change. But if we go back to more and more link to products, we go back to the old type of distortions. There is a very big debate about the manner of by which so-called green payments, you know, direct payments and requirements to do certain things that are good for the environment and the agro-environmental measures overlap to each other, and how you can simplify what we do but also increase the overall ambition. And then there is a never-ending question, and what do you do about the budget? And that's a lot of budget for a very small overall budget. It might be small in terms of public expenditure, it's big in terms of the EU budget. And the most important question here is how you can prove that you get what you ask for from this budget, especially because, at least if I go back to my textbooks from my university years, there is a very cheap way of cutting down the budget and also increasing enormously trade distortions. And the real question is how you can, at the same time, address the challenges of the future, which are costly, without shifting the burden of the solutions for you on others. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tassos, for your, as always, provoking presentations and thoughts. I want to thank all the presenters and the discussants for really giving excellent presentations and comments and ideas. We have about 30 minutes for discussions. I'm going to ask Lara and Jean-Christophe if they have reactions to some of the discussants to do that. I mean, in a bit, I'm first going to collect some questions and comments. I have one small point, is that since Tassos is in charge of impact assessment in the European Commission, so his idea on impact should be taken very seriously. And so he demonstrated that since we started the food secure projects, the markets have stabilized and the high price food prices have declined. So Hans, I suggest you take that to the evaluation of the project session, and said that the Commission, the DG AGRI, said so, so it must be true. Of course, we can, as the projects end in 6 months, people can already start speculating what's going to happen to the food prices then in February. Okay, with that, I'm opening the floor. I'm going to take a series of questions, and then I should also emphasize that there will be a second panel, of course, after this one, a science panel, and if you have some issues which are more related to that part, you can also wait until then. Please. Everything's clear, yeah. Or everybody's intimidated. I don't think that this public would be intimidated. That's why we invited you, Aleko, to open the faucet. Yeah.
This one. All right. I think through the various partial presentations, yet I have a. There's a microphone here. Identify myself. I'm Alexandros Saris, professor at the University of Athens in Greece. The various partial presentations, as well as the other, I did not get the message of whether the EU policies are coherent with global food security or not. Are they or are they not? And if they're not, then which ones are not coherent? That's my simple question.
Okay. Other questions, comments? Please. Maximo.
David. Only following what Tassos showed.
Maximo, can you? I think we all know you, but just.
Oh, Maximo Torero from IFPRI. My comment is linking the graph of Tassos and the price and the volatility issue, which basically is showing that this is a cyclical thing. No, it gaps goes up, then it goes down, and we are facing now a downward situation where we have a lower volatility, what we call, for example, excessive volatility zero since the last 3 years, with one exception of soybeans of 3 days in 2016. But that doesn't mean that the problem is resolved. And basically what you show that there is a linkage with the oil, a linkage with the fertilizer prices also, but the changes are bigger even in those areas, which is completely consistent with the market structure behind fertilizers, which is also highly concentrated in terms of the companies producing and trading fertilizers. So my question was more related to, okay, how clear is that really we have not resolved the structural problems behind? And how much the improvement of the coherences of policies in the EU could help to resolve that. You were referring at the issue of reserves, and that's something that there is work being done to move on the reserve of the ECOWAS. But again, if we were thinking of a combination of physical and virtual, meaning virtual, not necessarily commodity, but other types of instruments that could allow, cash instruments that could allow to have access, the price effect that you were saying wouldn't have happened, and it would be a more smart design in terms of coping with that potential volatility of the prices that we are seeing today. So how can we see in which areas of the policies we are really moving to resolve the structural problems that are behind these issues that we are facing every 10 years or so, or 20, so that we can say, okay, now it doesn't matter really to look more at volatility. Because I don't see any tool at this point that really is targeted to coping with these issues of price volatility that we face in the 2007.
Okay, David?
David Zilberman, University of California, Berkeley. It was really interesting panel. I have two basic questions. Question number one is, when we speak about what are the real policy objective of the EU development policy, the answer is food security and nutrition security. But the question is, does anyone do a political economy that try to look how it linked to the business interest of the different member of the EU and why one of the and why the division of distribution of resources is occurring the way it is? Because it's really futile to speak about let's have a mainstream policy when the real objectives are totally different than what people pretend they are. That's number one. And number two is what type of constant or permanent or continuous policy analysis would you see from the EU or from some other institution to really better understand what's going on a permanent basis and to have a basic knowledge of it rather than once in a while to have a big study like this.
Okay. Alan, you had a comment?
Sorry. Alan Matthews, University of Dublin. Tassos showed us a graph how the level of prices had changed between the beginning of the project and today. And in answering Aleko's question, it seems to me that you have to answer the question which you yourself posed, Chair, in a paper, a very interesting paper some years ago about the implications of high or low food prices for food security, poverty in general, but particularly for food security. So the idea was that during the defensive period of the CAP, we overproduced in Europe, we depressed world market prices, we undermined farmers in developing countries, that's where the largest food insecurity was, so therefore we were damaging food insecurity at a global level when prices went high, maybe because of biofuel policies, as well as many other things. Then we were also damaging food security because by then maybe more food insecure had moved into urban areas. Now we see prices falling again. So what are the implications of that? What does the project tell us in terms of the likely implications, particularly when the economic analysis seem to try to, in a sense, straddle both fences by arguing that even when food prices went high and we worried about the impact on consumers, that when we took the indirect effects in terms of impacts on rural labor markets and wages and so on, actually consumers maybe weren't so badly off. So now food prices are falling, you know, do we actually put that process into reverse? So I'm kind of asking you to does the project to give us any insights into what we might expect if indeed we are into a period of lower food prices at the global level?
Okay, thank you very much. I have, for the moment, I have one question there, and Ruurt had a question. Anybody else? Well, you can come later. Please.
Thank you. Olive Towie from Concern and Alliance 2015. So we launched the Global Hunger Index report last night with IFPRI, and the theme was getting to zero hunger faster. And what the Global Hunger Index shows is that already we're lagging far behind in the objective of reaching zero hunger by 2030, and that the particular focus we need to have is on those left behind, on those fragile states. And my question is, clearly EU's development policy has a very strong food and nutrition security focus in fragile states, but has there been analysis of the impact of policies beyond EU development policy and how those trade, agriculture, fisheries policies impact on the food nutrition security of particularly the 50 countries whose hunger levels are serious or extremely alarming? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ruurt?
Should I press this one? Ruurt Ruben, Wageningen University. A lot of information about prices, but very little by the panel on the transaction cost. Now, the African import bill of food is rising rapidly. Nobody showed that, but people are going to cities, and a lot of the food that is consumed in city is imported because local transaction costs are so high. I'm always surprised that the European Union has invested so little in infrastructure. So the counterfactual, could it be that we have to invest more in infrastructure instead of price stabilization policies? Because I think that will be the main problem in the very near future.
Okay, very good. Other comments, questions? I think I'll just take all the questions now before going back to the panel. Then, yes, please.
Good afternoon, I'm Hanna Saarinen with Oxfam International. My question is about the EU development policy in agriculture and food security, the one that Mr. Halkin mentioned, the food security policy framework developed in 2010, which we consider is an excellent policy. It focuses on small-scale producers, on women, and it's a very good policy framework. What we witness in recent years is the shift away from this small-scale producer focus towards more private sector-led agriculture development, which this change in narrative was quite prominent, for example, in the latest biennial monitoring report, the one that was published in June 2016, which had quite a strong focus on private sector actors and development. So my question is, what's the driver of this change away from the small-scale producer focus towards more private sector-led agriculture? And secondly, what role can we expect in future EU support to agriculture and food and nutrition security sectors? What role can we expect for small-scale producers? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Other questions or comments? No. All right. I propose then that we go back to the panel, and I propose we go back in the same order as we spoke, from left, in this case from left to right, and I will skip my thing and I'll pick up in the end if there's still issues to be answered.
Thank you. Well, maybe one word on Tassos' presentation. I agree absolutely with what he said. I wouldn't really have the same view in terms of priorities in the future in what he said about environment. I think one point is that we may be underestimating, and it was actually part of the food secure project, but I didn't stress that, is the idea of the production potential in terms of agriculture, of course, not only, but also. And the idea that we are eroding some natural capital. I know that it sounds a bit Malthusian, and Malthusians have lost the battle for the last three decades because what they have predicted never happened. But still, we are facing some major irreversible changes, especially, I mean, including in Europe, not only in Europe, of course, in terms of natural capital. And one big issue in the next CAP is to preserve this production potential. I think it's absolutely underestimated. In France, we have 18% of the arable land that is being eroded. This is much less than the figures at the world level, but still it's really a problem of becoming a problem of production potential. And we also have this absolutely dramatic fall in biodiversity that we can see all over Western Europe, at least, because that's the only place where we have decent figures on birds and butterflies, not much for the rest. And I think this, I would have put that in your slide, Tassos, at a much more central place. And we can develop that if you want, because this is something we've done some work on. On the audience, the questions from the audience, I think several questions related to whether or not EU policies are, at least the ones we investigated, were coherent, or whether they were good for food security. I think on the ag policy, Alan Matthews has answered pretty much. I mean, I've got nothing to add. What we find is that it's now the CAP is relatively neutral in terms. So if you're neutral, you're kind of coherent, because at least you do no harm, or little harm. On the trade policy, one interesting finding of the project is a paper that is already a working paper, but which is submitted to a journal, is that at the world level, the multilateral negotiation, the multilateral trade liberalization, I mean WTO, has played basically no role in trade liberalization over the last 12 years, because that's where we have very good data only, so it's not a very long period, but still it's the first time we're able to put together detailed data, historical data. And very surprisingly, that free trade agreements, we've seen their number absolutely booming, so the preferential agreements, and including the European ones, play very, very little role. The big driver of trade liberalization worldwide is unilateral trade liberalization. It's emerging countries that have lowered their tariffs. The reasons are numerous. It can be related to your presentation. It's to get into global value chains. You squeeze yourself out if you have tariffs on your imports, for example. But this is really the big driver. And when you look at the, try to isolate the impact on trade liberalization in general of the EU trade agreements, you see very little. And when you go to the next step, translating these impacts into food security, well, really, we could not see anything. That's all.
So first of all, thank you for your discussion, Jean-Pierre. I'm glad that we mostly agree, although the focus is probably for me more on the fact that progress has been limited, and you focus on the fact that there has indeed been progress. And I do immediately want to admit that, first of all, the way we measure this has its limitations, and there is a lot of heterogeneity between the different member states, between different years, for example. So I think we mostly agree on all of that. Then with regards to the questions from the audience, I think the only one I can actually respond to is with regards to the political economy of aid allocation that you refer to. So I think there is a large literature on that. I don't think we've looked into this for food security specifically, but in general, it has been noted that aid is not necessarily allocated based on which countries are most in need or which countries are most likely to be able to improve. And just anecdotally looking at the data we have on aid for food and nutrition security, you see that donors usually give a lot of aid for food and nutrition security to countries that just receive a lot of aid from them in general. So it's not necessarily based on an analysis of where they think that food security is very problematic. So that's definitely a part of the story. You also see problems with donor herding. So once a country gains popularity, becomes a donor darling in terms of food security, all the other donors move there as well. So allocation is definitely very much determined by a whole lot of other incentives. And that's part of the problem with regards to aid effectiveness. That's it.
On prices, what is the impact on producer and consumers? Of course, it depends. Because when the prices increase, farmers, as I said, are not getting, that much increase in the prices, whereas consumers are affected much more. In fact, some of our analysis showed that net buyers are higher number, even in rural areas, including agriculture laborers. But agriculture laborers, of course, wages may increase with a lag. In general, prices can have some impact, but low food prices are much more important for poverty reduction and food and nutrition security. But it depends, again, on the... But I agree that transaction costs and other infrastructure measures are much more important, and the value chains also may have impact on the prices, more stabilization of prices. On global hunger index, it is true that the global hunger index report showed that, there is a significant progress, but some of the countries' severe malnutrition and other indicators it showed. But the report shows that, if you business as usual, you may not achieve this zero hunger and thing. So we have to improve our policies to get there by 2030. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. There are many questions which are very important to us. The first of all I would like to address is the coherence between the food and nutrition policy in external assistance and key internal policies, the CAP, and also the policy on public health in European Union. Because whenever we speak about nutrition security, malnutrition is not only undernutrition, it's also overnutrition. And this is certainly a growing challenge for the European Union. We immediately see that the circumstances are very different for developing countries and EU member states, and it is normal that those policies don't have the same objectives, which are adapted to the context. For me, the most important is that those policies are not competing with each other. They are certainly strengthening each other. We may not have been in a position to say the same just a few years from now. We've seen from the presentation from Tassos that there are some hot elements of the CAP which have disappeared, notably export subsidies, and certainly Tassos will say a bit more. But for me, my firm conviction is that those policies are coherent with each other and not in competition with each other. I will move now to one of a few other questions. Certainly, there was a question regarding food and nutrition security, and also the connection with the private sector and also EU interest. I would say that if there is a connection with EU interest, it is not the one from the private sector. Very often it is much more political interests which are driving our intervention than private sector interests. The only very hot issues we had with an involvement of the private sector was the reform of the trade regime for banana and sugar, where for many years there was a specific trade regime which was given to ACP countries, and after an WTO ruling, we had to adapt the trade regime to the global regime for developing countries, and we have provided support to partner countries, and we were aware for sure that many countries which were producing sugarcane or banana were also in contact with EU private sector, since they were exporting to the European Union. But I have not, it is not going further than that. There was a very strong point made by Oxfam regarding also the shift in intervention between supporting smallholder farmers and working with the private sector. This is a very hot debate among us, with the CSO, with the parliament, and the rationale behind this is really the concept of rural transformation. It is based on the evidences we have that farm size in many developing countries is shrinking, that the capacity of farmers to invest is going down, and farmers need to have more services in order to face challenges. And they need to have services as farmers in Europe have access to services. They need to have access to financial services, expertise in agriculture, advice on which pesticide maybe to use in case there is a disease spreading. They have to be also able to process food locally. They have to be able to sell it at a better price, to sell it whenever they want. So if we are behind the concept of this rural transformation, then we need to shift also the support of going only to the producer to cover more actors in the value chain. And it goes together with also a stronger look at the governance of the value chain. And I believe this is really in the interest of the weakest link of the chain, which is very often the farmer himself or often herself. That's something very important. There was an assumption on reducing investment in infrastructure. I would say not that much. The change is that now investment in infrastructure is made through the investment facility, so it is a different model, but we are still extremely present in infrastructure. Now we should be very cautious in linking directly investment in infrastructure with, for instance, reduction of the price of fertilizers. We have nice stories which show that also governance is a very important price, a very important element of the price of fertilizers. We see that in Africa, I believe it was in one landlocked country, Zambia, price of fertilizer were extremely high, but transport cost was not at all justifying all. It was linked to the fiscal policy and other aspects which are also connected to governance that were justifying the fact that fertilizers were very expensive, connected also to the fact that there were a very low number of people who are importing fertilizers. So, I mean, it's more complicated than that, and we risk to fall into the good intention, which is very expensive with no real impact. There were also elements connected to the level of information we have. First of all, we are collecting information about food security, food production, agriculture in developing countries on a yearly basis. That's something where we are getting better and better. There was also a question regarding the connection between the situation of a country with its aid allocation. And I must say that the EU has a very transparent way to compute and develop the envelope of a country according to a certain number of indicators which are public and discussed. Where we've been quite good is also to connect the amount dedicated to food security or agriculture to the country situation. And we've called it evidence-based programming to be sure that whenever we intervene in a country which is facing food security or nutrition security or agricultural challenge, we address the causes of those challenges at the same time as we put resources there. So this is something very important. And I will close on the remark made by Lara on weak evidences of progress. I can just agree on that. And we've also weak evidences on impact of our action on nutrition. But the point is that today, and this is really a message also for the scientific community, we know that if we speak about nutrition, we cannot connect what we do in agriculture, what we do in food security, with the impact on stunting. I mean, on stunting, we have only 10 measures which are nutrition specific, which are the one for which we have some understanding with evident proof that it is going to work, as long as we separate the action from one to the other. Once we combine, even though the evidences of the success is more discrete. So if we want to have evidences on our impact, there is a call to also to the scientific community, and I believe it's really for all of us, to improve our way to assess the impact of an action in agriculture, an action in food security, on the beneficiary. And we know that there are many externalities which are hampering this those progress. But certainly it's very difficult to say that we have been achieving or not while there is no measure of impact which is agreed by any scientific body. I mean, if we speak about social transfer, we can assume it is working, but we don't have any proof. That's something very important. It is a bit my closure with this call for more and more evidence to drive our action, and that's really why we are so interested also to be here.
Very briefly, first of all, to Aleko's question. As far as I'm concerned, yes, the CAP reform process made the CAP much more consistent to the objectives of making it much less trade distorting than what it has been, and thus being much more consistent with the aims of the development policies. Does this make it a perfect policy? Far from it. But most of the problems we have are problems that affect much more the distribution of payments and the internal aspects of the common agricultural policy in EU agriculture and not the world. Now, cyclical or not cyclical, what the price level? Well, if you look at my graph, the first thing that you see is that there is a clear reversal of what we learned, all that we have a long-term downward trend in agricultural prices and other prices. So that poses major question marks about how long this is going to last and whether it's going to last. And if you have this type of uncertainty about what will happen in the future, this has implications from the policy design to investment. And that is why I believe much bigger problem than the volatility has always been the uncertainty about the price level. But I think we have to ask ourselves when it comes to food security and the food security debate, what is the problem we are trying to solve? Is it the problem of the quantity produced of food around the world? This was the problem 5 years ago. We looked at the level of stocks and other things, and that's what we said was the problem. It's not the problem anymore. And it doesn't seem that necessarily will be the problem. Much more is a problem of the distribution of this food and the uneven opportunities that exist. Second, Jean-Christophe, you're right. I put it very simplistically. In other presentations, you will see most of my focus is exactly on the natural resources. In fact, I like to present agriculture in the EU as the 2% sector, the 40% sector, which is land management, and the 100% sector, which is food, with most of my focus exactly on addressing land management issues, for which climate change plays a role of the alarm that sounds very loud for everybody to listen to what it says. There is an issue on the price level also, and the different interests between the rural and the urban population and poor in the developing countries. Low prices make one thing for the urban poor and a completely different thing for the rural poor. In the EU itself, we don't have a tension between what our producers want to produce and what our consumers want. It's much more demand-driven, the type of production we're having internally. Infrastructure does play a major role, especially in this context. And in the context of budgetary constraints, where you spend your money also plays a major role. These big projects that Brazil had to move all the soy and corn in the north and then to China, in the current situation, probably will never materialize. David, political economy is not for us to analyze, it's for you to analyze, and we're the guinea pigs. But what is very important, I think, is to somewhere draw a line between a theory that has been developed based on the experience of the US political system and the EU one. The EU one is extremely different, and I think the political economy of the EU is so complex that it's worth addressing from scratch with empirical evidence before the theory is developed. And finally, on the issues of hunger, I'm not a development economist, and I don't profess to know much about that. But when I go into debates like this, one thing that surprises me is how often we tend to forget that it's not going to be agriculture that will be the big solution to hunger problems. It contributes, and contributes significantly, especially in developing countries.
But if we don't solve the overall problems of the economy, where agriculture is only a small sector, where in the world are we going to generate the additional type of jobs that would resolve these issues of hunger? And I think this is the big missing element in the debates that we have very often, not only when it comes to developing countries, but when it comes internally in the EU about the prospects of the overall economy. Thank you.
Excellent. I have, it's 15:38, and I just got the announcement that Tony Martin won the World Championship time trial, if you are interested in, by crushing his competitors. So I'm just going to, very 1 minute ending here. I'm actually, this is the first time I've been in a meeting, I think, a discussion in Brussels or in the EU arena, that somebody made a case for GMOs and there was no discussion on that point. So I'm not sure whether, you can interpret that in all kinds of ways. Also, very briefly on Aleko's point, are the EU policies coherent? I think in terms of the EU standards, that's the point I discussed about. So I think in particularly outside the EU effects, okay, development effects. So the claim is they are essentially, people argue that they're always non-tariff barriers and they're excluding smallholders because of transaction costs. I think that's not true. Okay, I think in several cases they are actually coherent, but it is also true that in some cases they are actually non-tariff barriers. So it's a very mixed conclusion, I think, and it's case-specific, which in a way is great news for trade lawyers. Great news for trade lawyers because they can probably make a lot of money in court on these things. The other thing is that they actually, and you see these what they kind of do, they uplift, they upgrade, if you want, the value chains. And if the smallholders can get into that, and in a number of, there's various cases where they can actually, with help both from the private sector, from the public sector, typically you got endogenous vertical coordination happening with all kinds of spillover effects, and which is typically good for reducing poverty and improving food security. Ruth, your point on infrastructure, I should apologize. It was on my list, but somehow I think I had to cut it down to 2 slides and somehow it got lost, but yes, absolutely. Infrastructure. And so my last point is on Alan's point, whether high prices or low prices are good for food security. Essentially, there has now been an increasing number of empirical studies, and they, what is, I think, encouraging is they essentially show what economists would predict. Okay, so that the impact depends on whether you're a net buyer or a net producer, whether the transaction cost, the trade cost, etc. And so most of the studies actually are consistent with that. The most interesting recent development, I think, in that area is that one of the only studies, which most of these are case studies of a particular country or whatever. So the only study which has tried to model this thing, as far as I know, on the global effect on food security, on they measure poverty effects, not food security, is by Will Martin and Ivanich from the World Bank. And of course, initially the World Bank came out with that 75 to 100 million people would go into poverty because of the high prices. So after receiving a substantial amount of comments on that study and the methodology, including for myself, they have now redone their analysis, and essentially they brought in the longer term effects, they brought in supply responses, which were not there initially, they brought in labor market effects. And so the newest results, okay, it's actually a very nice study, and they have a fantastic one column of one Excel sheet, which you can use in your classes, which is great. Essentially that high prices are good for the poor, okay? Except in the extreme situation where you have a very high increase in prices, no supply response, no labor market effects, and short run effects, okay? In all other cases, high prices are good, which I guess is bad news for the poor in the world right now. But then again, you know, if urbanization continues, maybe the aggregate effect may change. And so again, I think it depends on the country level if you're in a particular case. Okay, with that, we have run 10 minutes over time, and so I will invite you for coffee now on behalf of the organizer. Thank you all on the panel.